Test your might. Test your might. Test your might.
Just want to welcome everybody to the show here, and it's our absolute pleasure to host our guest today. Man, if you grew up in the 90s, you definitely know this guy's work and are a big fan. He's a very accomplished martial artist, master in karate and many other styles, an accomplished actor and action star, a best-selling author, CEO of Red Dragon Karate, and much more that we'll go over. Welcome Chris Casamassa to the show.
Hey Tom, thanks for having me, man. I appreciate it. That was a good job on that video, by the way. You put that together?
I did.
I should hire you as my new publicist. That was pretty good.
Thanks. Hey, you know, in this day and age, we got extra time, and I've been working hard with stuff. How are you doing, man?
I'm doing as good as we can do, given the current climate of America today.
So, what are you doing right now? I always ask people that come on a show just how you're kind of coping with things. What are you doing now that we got this craziness going on in the world?
Well, I don't know if fortunate is the right word, but we got ahead of this curve when I saw it coming. So middle of March, I decided to take our entire company online and go virtual. I saw what was happening in China, saw what was happening in Italy. I figured, listen, it's coming to America and it's probably going to happen. So I just literally, no joke, for like 7 days straight, I dove into everything I could about online training, online platforms, how to make that pivot, created emails, communication with my members so that I could move everybody from a brick and mortar business to an online business. It took me quite literally 7 days straight. I think I slept maybe 8 to 10 hours over the course.
Oh, man.
Listen, yeah. I didn't want to lose my business. I didn't want to have the rest of my company go away for something like this. So we pivoted fast and we pivoted early, and it made a big help. We've been able to keep roughly about 85% of our customers training and active during the last 6-7 weeks of this shutdown. In California, where I'm at now, they're just starting the reopening phases. So we're hopeful to potentially get some people back through the door around the 18th to the 25th of May.
Oh, okay.
The excitement. There's a storm today.
Right? Yeah, that's awesome. You saw that storm coming and adjusted. I myself, we primarily focus on Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, Sambo, Judo, and you know, there's a lot of hands-on with that. So, I mean, we can do band exercises. There's some dummy exercises, solo drills, but I started training people in Gymnastica Natural, which is a lot of movement training.
Okay.
That's the best we can do, and it's created other things like this. We usually do high-end seminars with guys like such as yourself in person at our academy, but we can't do that right now. And we switch things over to doing online interviews. And I find this has been keeping people not only entertained, but it's motivating, inspiring people as well to keep going.
Yeah, and they should listen. I don't know. You're in Illinois, yeah?
Mm-hmm, yes.
Well, I don't know what is currently going on in your state, what part of the shutdown you're on, or if you guys are allowed to reopen. But no matter what, people need to stay active, right? That sense of normalcy, really the overwhelming support we've gotten from our members and from the people that we've helped like almost 100 martial arts school owners at this point pivot and make these system adjustments. But the overwhelming response has been, thank you for keeping our kids going and having some sense of normalcy. Because literally, as you know, everything else got shut down, right? Baseball, soccer, football, every outdoor activity. The cool thing about martial arts is it's one of the few sports that translates to online, that can be done online, can keep them active, can keep them healthy, can keep them safe and fit and strong. So it's super important for people to stay active.
For sure. I couldn't agree more. Well, let's go into a little bit of background. I'd like to start touching base. You are the CEO of Red Dragon Karate. And I just like kind of go over the the history of that. I find that very interesting with that alone. Let's hear that.
Well, thank you. So Red Dragon Karate was started by my father in 1965. He was in the Marine Corps. He's a Marine Corps vet. And during his time he was stationed in Japan is where he first fell in love with the martial arts. And he started training there. He was a military police officer in the art of judo, which is, okay. That's his first love. And he basically fell in love with the martial arts. He stuck with it long enough to make it all the way to secondary black belt in judo in Japan. And at that time, like if you remember your history, we had recently blown up that country. So they did not like Americans at all. And they were doing everything in their power to get him to quit, to get him to get out. They didn't want the Americans in there at all. But my dad has a couple of things going for him. He's Italian, he's stubborn, and he's from the East Coast. So he wasn't quitting. He wasn't giving up. And he, he stuck it out, made it to black belt, fell in love with it, and basically traveled around the country, traveled around the world, learning different martial arts. And today, he holds black belts in 10 different styles of martial arts. Now, he never really liked any one style. He kind of liked them all. So in the 1960s, he did something that was, at the time, unheard of. He took the styles that he learned, and he started combining them and putting them together.
Oh, wow.
Now, for anybody that's been in the martial arts for more than a minute, and you go back in the day, back in the 60s especially, 60s, 70s, you supposedly weren't allowed to mix styles. You were either a Japanese stylist, you were a Korean stylist, you were a Brazilian stylist, you were, that was it.
Yeah.
So at the time for him, mixing styles was, it seemed natural to him, but it was, everyone hated it. And he got so much flack. And back in those days as well, the old school method of, you can't do this went like this. I would come to your school and challenge you. If you lost, you had to close.
Wow.
That's how it went back in the day. For the old school martial artists, anybody watching, if you've been in martial arts 20, 30, 40 years, you know that that's true. So what I like to tell people is, A, it's 55 years later. We're still around. So my dad's a badass. He never lost. And B, to everybody that has a mixed martial arts school in America today, I would just like to say, you're welcome. So that's kind of the brief history of Red Dragon Karate. And in the mid-70s, my dad came out to California. He got tired of the weather. We're from the East Coast, from Pennsylvania, New York originally. But he came to California, just got tired of being cold all the time. And we set up shop out here.
That's awesome. And such a just a pioneer. I mean, like you said, it's common now, but very much a pioneer in itself.
Yeah, I could throw a rock from where I'm sitting right now and hit a mixed martial arts school.
Yeah, it's all over the place.
It should be. There's nothing wrong with mixing martial arts. There's nothing wrong with people that are doing it now today. It's great with the rise of the UFC and the Gracie family and all that. They brought all that to light, and it's great. It's been great for the martial arts. It's been great for business, and it's been great for the consumer as well. So,
awesome. Yeah, we had weights out, and it was amazing hearing the stories on that. And yeah, to me, that's a good kind of segue point. To me, there. In the U.S. at least, there's been three major booms for martial arts. So like the late 60s, early 70s, it was Bruce Lee kind of like the top of that heap. Obviously, a lot of other people were following suit. 1980s was Karate Kid. And you, to me, the third would be like UFC as far as big splurges of interest in martial arts. You, sir, were in Karate Kid.
Was.
Yeah. That's amazing. Like, what was that like? You were like in the audience, right?
Sorry?
You were in the audience or?
Yeah, background fighting and stuff. It was like my very first foray into the movie world.
That's amazing. And you had, how'd you kind of land that? Did you guys know Pat Johnson, the referee of Karate Kid? Or?
I didn't know him really at that point. What happened was that was in the background of Karate Kid. That's a real karate tournament. When they show those big panning shots. Oh. So I was competing locally at the time. And it just so happened that tournament was going to be the background for those scenes in the Karate Kid. So I just happened to be there, and they're like, all right, who wants to stick around and do this? I was like, I do.
That's amazing. And about, I don't know, like 8 or 9 years later, you were in Shoot Fighter, Fight to the Death, and with stars William Zabrick, Johnny, and the actor that played Kreese, Martin Cove.
Right.
It kind of comes full circle somehow, right?
Right.
That was a pretty hardcore movie, by the way. If anybody's wanting a good martial arts movie, check out.
Yeah, there you go. If you need some binge watching, just get Shoot Fighter, Fight to the Death.
There you go. I mean, Bolo Young and everything, right?
Yeah, Yeah, which was great to work with him because I was a fan like a lot of people growing up during that time. Bruce Lee was my movie hero that I always wanted to be like. So to be able to do a film with him and then with Marty Koh from Karate Kid and Billy Zabka. So it was, it was really great to meet with them and to get to work with them.
Amazing. I don't want to go over to every little detail, but let's fast forward into one of the best video game and movies ever, and that's Mortal Kombat. Amazing movie. It came out in 1995. Were you a fan of the games before you took the role? Like, were you playing? Or?
I was. Actually, I was a real big fan of the video games. And someone, I did an interview last month, someone asked me this question, but this is true. I wasn't necessarily a fan of Scorpion. My number one character was Raiden.
Oh.
I liked Raiden because he could shoot those lightning bolts, he could go flying across the screen, he could disappear. It was cool. Raiden was my number one, and Scorpion was my number two. So those are my two favorite characters. But because everybody goes, oh, you were a fan of Scorpion. I'm like, I was a fan of Raiden. But of course, now forget it. I'd like Scorpion's my number one.
Oh yeah, of course. It does such an amazing job with that. And actually, I talked to the first Scorpion before I talked to the second Scorpion, Master Danny Pacina, on Wednesday. Amazing guy. And I see that you guys are actually going to be doing an Instagram Live on the 27th of May.
Yeah, end of this month.
Oh, that's awesome. Got the two Scorpions head to head, right? Now, just kind of go over the movie a little bit. There was an interesting part of the scene that you guys were shooting for this in Thailand. What's the story about cobras?
Well, so in Thailand, where we shot the opening of the fight scene between Scorpion and Johnny Cage, there's a rubber tree plantation that they kind of stumbled upon and go, wow, this is going to be a great location. Little did we know, there were tons of snakes in the grass. And those snakes, they told us, were cobras. So every time that we would go to do a scene, they had guys, like Thailand native guys, with fire sticks and drums. And it's no joke. So they had those, like just like you see in a movie, like a fire torch.
Yeah.
And they would bang on the drum and go through the brush like this with the fire stick, and you would hear the snakes slither away. And then the director would go, and action. And we had to go in there and do stuff. And then they would say cut, and you could hear them starting to come back.
Oh.
So it was pretty trippy when we were doing it.
That's crazy. And there's another interesting story of how you got the role, right? It was like down to three guys. What was that story? I thought it was very interesting.
Well, it's kind of a long story, but I'll make it as short as possible. So Mortal Kombat was my first major motion picture that I was in, right? You said, Shoot Fighter and Karate Kid, those background guys. So it doesn't necessarily count, although I was in it. I did, Return of the Ninja, China O'Brien, a bunch of small independent films. And Mortal Kombat came about almost on accident. Again, they were auditioning people for background fighters. But it was, at that time, for that era, it was a big budget film. It was, I think, $30, $35 million film, something like that. And I go, okay, I want to do this. And I knew somebody who knew somebody that said they're auditioning background fighters. So we go there. It's probably about 100 guys there. And, everyone has to showcase their stuff. And it was kind of set up nice for me because they had three people sitting in chairs and they kind of had an area taped off, which looked to me just like a tournament. And at that time, I was the number one competitor in the country. So I'm like, well, this is right up my alley. So they go do some stuff. And I wanted to do something that set me apart because there were some guys there that were really good. And I was like, wow, these guys are pretty good, but I think I got an idea. So I start doing my kata, I start doing my routine. And in my head, I'm like, I can make it over those guys. So I ran towards them. I did a jump sidekick over them. And it was cool because I still remember to this day. I remember them going like this.
Yeah.
And on the other side, dove back over them and then finished my routine. That night, I get a phone call. It says, hey, we want you to come back. I'm like, cool. Go back the next day. So now they ask us to do some weapons, more stuff. Now it's maybe 25 guys, smaller group. And in the beginning, they told us the whole time, they go, all the roles are cast. We just need background fighters. If you remember the movie, like when Goro's fighting and Johnny Cage's fighting, there's background people cheering.
Oh, yeah.
That's literally what I was auditioning for. One of those guys like, which I thought is going to be cool, major motion picture. So I go back second time, do some weapon stuff. I get a call that night and they go, we want you to come back again. At this point, I'm thinking, man, it's hard to get into a major motion picture. Maybe I should stick to these independent films. My third time, I've got to go back. That's the part where you said there was three guys left. It was me and two other guys. They have a movie camera set up. They've got some lights. They have a bunch of people I've never seen before. And they're just basically filming us with the camera. And the director walks over and he says, He goes, hey, would you guys mind taking off your shirts? This is where the story turns a little bit, because I'm kind of a smart ass. So I looked at him and I said, well, if it'll help me get the role, I'll be happy to go back to your trailer. Your laugh is what I was expecting. But what I got was,
oh, no.
And I'm like, this is it. I'm not even going to be in this movie. I'm out. We still don't know what it's for. So we take off our shirts. And of course, I've always tried to keep myself in really good shape. So I'm flexing, trying to act like I'm not flexing. I look to my left, guy on my left, he's got a little bit of pot belly. Look to my right, guy over there, he's in good shape, but he's a little hairy. So I'm like, we're standing there. They take the camera and they film, just like this, like, they're going over us. They go into a football huddle. The guy walks over, shakes my hand, who I didn't know at the time, but he was the director. And the guy that said, would you take shirts off, was the director of the movie.
Oh.
And he actually gave me deadpan. So he comes over, shakes my hand, he goes, welcome to Mortal Kombat. You are going to be Scorpion.
Whoa.
And that's how it happened.
That's how it went down. Amazing.
And looking back on it, like, I don't know if the roles were full when I first went in or if they just didn't want to tell anybody that. I'm glad that they did, because I probably would have freaked out. Be like, oh my God, I could be Scorpion or Sub-Zero or whatever. But it just kind of worked out that way. And, you know, because people go, oh, you were so lucky. And I always tell people, listen, it's not luck. It's talent and preparation. Right? I spent my whole life preparing for that moment. I got that moment and I just took advantage of it.
That's an amazing story how it went down. And the surprise at the end. Probably one of my favorite, definitely between the two movies, my favorite fight scene, if not in any movie, was between you and Johnny Cage. I just want to kind of go over that a little bit, because it was awesome. How much were you and Lyndon Ashby like involved in the choreography and also the famous the Scorpion pose? Was that all? Was that part you, or little bits and pieces? How did that go about?
Well, the main thrust of the fight was choreographed by Pat Johnson. Now, Pat, who I had worked with on Karate Kid, but didn't really know him at the time, he took a chance on me after Karate Kid because he saw me do some stuff there. And that's how he put me in Shoot Fighter, because he also did the fight choreography for that.
Okay,
so for those of you that are aspiring actors or stunt people in Hollywood, I'm going to give you the secret right here. Here's the deal. It's not who you know in Hollywood. It's who knows you. And the connections that you make can last a lifetime. One of the things my dad taught me was be humble, be kind, be respectful. So every movie set I was ever on, all the small films, even the big ones that I've worked on, same, my mindset's the same. Yes, sir, no, sir. I never walk in there with ego. And that paid off because Pat remembered that. He remembered that. He's the one that called me in for the auditions on Mortal Kombat for the background fighters. So he's the creative genius that did all the Ninja Turtle movies. He did all the Karate Kid movies. He did Batman and Robin. He did Mortal Kombat. So he is an amazing stunt coordinator and fight choreographer. Wow. One of the great things I like about working with him is he lets the talent do their stuff. In other words, he'll come to you and go, okay, fight needs to start here. It's got to go here. It needs to have this flow. There needs to be this conflict. You guys work it out. Do your moves. So rather than him trying to say, I want you to do this move, that move, he just says, create it, show it to me.
Okay.
Then he goes, no, this isn't going to work. That's going to work. Then he'll add moves, take moves out. So it's a really fluid process of working with him. It's one of the reasons why I love working with him. He's a really great guy. And it allowed us to shape that fight. So the answer to your question is, Lyndon and I had a ton of input in the fight. This move is all mine. I created that because here's the thing. When we first were filming, they had no idea what the creature was going to be. They didn't know if it was going to be a spear, it was going to be a creature. So they just came up to me and they go, listen, act as if something's coming out of your hand. So we need you to take a stance. We need you to do a pose. You got to create something where our computer animators can do something with your hand. So I kind of was thinking about it. Tried a couple different ones. They didn't work. And then I finally settled on just getting back and setting into that position.
It's so iconic. I mean, and what's it feel like, man? Like I said, like there were so many video game to movie things happening at the time, like Mario Brothers, Street Fighter, and a lot were struggling and more combat. I mean, number one, it did better than expected, and you know, by even the cast that I've learned, but also it holds up to this day.
Well, thank you very much. Listen, and that was it. I mean, we had the industry expectations for our movie were very low because Mario Bros. Had come out, Street Fighter had come out, Tank, Double Dragon came out,
yeah.
Tank. So when we were doing Mortal Kombat, like everybody predicted this movie's going to be terrible, boom, boom, boom. Pat's a great fight choreographer, but Larry Kazanoff, the producer, is even smarter. He brought in real martial artists to do the action, to do justice to the game. And that's kind of some of the mistakes that maybe some of the other franchises made. Paul Anderson was a great director. Our director of photography shot, like, you see that set, and our set designer, like, it was a perfect storm of everything going right at the right moment. And then when it came out, like, it was number one, I think, for 4 or 5 weeks in a row, ended up doing over $100 million at the box office, which today isn't a lot.
Right, but
back then, you know, it's, you know, and it's a billion-dollar franchise at this point. So, you know.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. And man, the scorpion lenses, I mean, they look real gnarly. Could you see good with that?
I could not see. It was like being in London at midnight in their worst fog storm imaginable. I tell you what, I couldn't see anything 3 feet or farther in front of me. I might as well have been blind.
It was just so, like,
everything that was coming at me at the last second, I would have to see it and move and react to it.
Oh man, that's crazy. And how was the uniform, the costume, did that move good and all that? Or
was, yeah, that one was great. It was easy to move in. It was the undersuit is all black. It was spandex, so it moved with me. The leather parts on top were very flexible, very movable.
Awesome. And man, how often you get approached about portraying that character? Because it was so well done.
Oh, well, listen, here's the thing. I love my fans. I love the Mortal Kombat fans. It's a great community. They have kept this thing going and alive for nearly 30 years now. So I appreciate them. You know, I get a ton of them on Instagram. There's artists that draw pictures. I mean, people send me stuff all the time. I'm so appreciative and so humbled and honored by it that you know, it's basically become kind of a legacy that's come on. And I tell you what, I don't hate it. I'll tell you that. You know what I mean? You hear actors and like, oh, I don't like this, I don't like that. I love it. And because listen, the franchise wouldn't be successful if it wasn't for the fans. Bottom line.
Totally.
It's not about me. It's not about the other cast members. It's the people who went, saw the movie, bought the videotape. You remember a videotape cassette? Bought the DVD, the Blu-ray, who are renting it on Netflix, who are watching it there. Those are the people that are most important to that franchise because they keep it going. You know, and the video game creators, they keep, you know, they're bringing out new versions of Mortal Kombat all the time. So it's, again, it's kind of a perfect storm of how to do things the right way.
I totally agree. That's amazing. I want to switch gears here real quick. I remember this was like on Saturday mornings, World Martial Arts Council.
Man, you've done your homework. I like it.
Well, I remember it. I like to research and stuff, and that's part of the fun, actually, for me, for doing this. And this was an awesome show. How involved were you in that, or how'd you get involved in it?
Again, one of those preparation and opportunity moments. So, again, this WMAC and Mortal Kombat happened almost concurrently. I had done the Mortal Kombat auditions and the pre-production stages of that. And I was still competing. Like, I was still actively competing. So I went to Atlanta for Joe Corley's tournament, the Battle of Atlanta, competed, and I won the grand championship up on the stage that night. When it was over, a couple people walked up to me, said they were producing a TV show called WMAC Masters, and they said, would you like to be in it? And I said, yes, please. I would love to do that. And, you know, we had gotten asked, me and all those people on that cover there were all competitors, all national champions, you know, Herb Perez, Olympic gold medalist, Hakeem Olsen, number one fighters in the world.
Also in Mortal Kombat, the beach scene where he fights Liu Kang,
yeah.
the monk.
Yep.
You had Ho Sung Pak, the original Liu Kang.
Yep.
Tai Mok, that's the, you know, the last dragon. And of course, Bruce Lee's daughter, Shannon Lee, who's an amazing actress and action star herself. Mm-hmm. Just a jam-packed show, and I always like, I like the little hat nod too. Red Dragon is in there as well.
Well, again, so here's the cool moment. They were coming up with character names, and they just go, so, all right, you guys are our original cast. I think there's six. And they go, what do you want your character name to be? And as a joke, because they knew I had Red Dragon Karate, I go, Red Dragon. And they looked at each other, they go, we like it. And I'm like, oh my God, this is going to be great.
Great. Yeah, even better. the choreography was again awesome throughout that whole series. And
hey, guess who choreographed?
Was it Pat Johnson or you?
Pat Johnson.
Oh, Pat Johnson. Wow, man. Yeah, he's just so involved. The more you guys, if nobody knows Pat Johnson, is probably most famous being the referee in Karate Kid, you know, visually. But behind the scenes, he's choreographed. Probably, if you've seen a fight film, he's probably done some sort of choreography for that.
He's responsible for over $1 billion in box office fight sequences. He has done it all, and he's an original student of Chuck Norris, I believe, as well.
Oh, that's right. Yes, so interesting. Awesome. Let's segue to another one of my personal. I'm nerding out just talking to you here because your career is my childhood. So, I mean, one of my all-time favorite movies is also Blade. And you saw maybe in a little clip, everybody. I know of at least that one scene. I'm not sure if you did other fight scene, but yeah, you were in this fight scene again. What was it like choreographing that and working with Wesley, who's also a martial arts master himself?
Wesley is full on legit, and it was great to work with him. You know, sometimes I've got to fight actors and not martial artists. Wesley is both. He is a great actor, and he is a black belt. He's a real martial artist, so it was awesome to work with him. The benefit of being in a vampire movie is you can get killed multiple times, so he and I fought 3 different times in that movie.
Okay.
I was called the recycled guy. I kept getting killed, but it was cool to do great stuff with him. He's very talented, awesome control, and just a great technician.
Awesome. Yeah, here, guys, here's a little clip. When he's all hopped up, going after Cross himself there. That was so well done. And, yeah, like you said, it's about who knows you. And everybody I talk to that knows you or met you or dealt with you, just nothing but amazing praise. And that actually, just researching you even more got me into this. And I thought, this is an amazing concept. Like I said, he is a best-selling author. I bought the book. I went through it. We have a kid's program as well. This works for, any style. It's not just for the kids, it's for the parents as well, which is a whole other mental and physical facet of, what people may not think of as much. So what kind of inspired you to the desire to get this message out to everybody?
Well, there's almost no week that goes by where you don't see some kind of news article, newspaper, online thing about the terrible effects of bullying. And whether it's just kids bullying kids getting picked on because of their weight, because they're obese, they're out of shape. It happens. And it's a horrible, horrible epidemic. Now, you and I are martial artists. So even I, have a bullying story from when I was a kid as a martial artist. The only reason I survived it and came out on the other side was because of my martial arts training. So we have that built-in confidence and swagger. You and I both impact the people in our communities, but my goal and really part of my mission and passion and purpose right now is I'm trying to get 1 million kids bully-proof and fit by 2025. Now, with that book and with our course, so far we've impacted just under 60,000 kids that have gone through the bully-proof training, become bully-proof certified, to help them live a better life where they can have better self-esteem, more confidence, more focus. And listen, if they're not in shape, it gives them the tools that they need to get on track and get the help that they want so that they can be more physically fit and be more active. So that my catalyst for it was I didn't want to just help my community. I wanted to help as many kids as I could around the world.
That's amazing. And, and again, that's the kind of person you are. And I really, really respect that. And everybody, this book really does cover everything: health, fitness, self-defense, nutrition. There's even like a grocery list. I mean, so all this cross information out there, it's a very good guidance on how to go about this. And actually, I just want to read this quote real quick. You have one of my favorite quotes in here. I'll just read here. No man has the right to be an amateur in the matter of physical training. It is a shame for a man to grow old without seeing the beauty and strength of which his body is capable. Socrates, one of the greatest, wisest minds in history, and there's different things out there that really help people get the grasp of that. And I highly endorse this book. And I actually, again, when we're done talking, I'm gonna give you a call and talk to you about a bunch of things, because I'd be interested in doing more with this, because I too involved in doing things, and anything that can help this out more, I'm all about it.
Right on, man. Thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Yeah. Another thing, speaking of which, I mean, another very interesting thing is you have, you're the dojo doctor.
Yes.
You know, and I know, you know, we have affiliations and we get help through that, but I always, in the firm belief, I'm sure there's other quotes on this too, but you always seek perfection knowing you'll never attain it, meaning you never stop learning, you never stop growing, and there's always a place you could do better. And if you're not, then you're not living, right? So could you just, a little synopsis, tell people exactly what the Dojo Doctor is all about here?
Well, what I do is I help martial arts school owners increase their student population so that they can live a better lifestyle and make a bigger impact in their community. That's really the bottom line. There are so many martial arts school owners out there that are struggling because, like you and I, they love the martial arts, but they don't know the business side of it. And so many people, even my dad included, got into the martial arts business, not because he wanted to make money, but because he loved teaching. He wanted to share his knowledge and passion with others. And he didn't know really, our company's made every mistake that you could possibly make, which is why it's a benefit now. And the reason why I'm helping school owners around the country, you see my map is kind of hidden behind me there. But we've got coaching and consulting clients in about 15, 16 different states now. And I've helped with the programs and things I put together, helped actually nearly 1,000 martial arts school owners grow and expand their business in one capacity or another. And I really, really enjoy doing that. And that's what I do. And we just do it through a process of systems, right? And my saying to all my people that I help and coach is, my systems have systems. So there is a method behind my madness, and I don't teach theory, which is the other great thing about having a school and a chain of schools is, if I tell you to do something for your business, it's not because I think it's going to work. It's because I've done it, I've tested it, I've tweaked it, I've retested it, and I've implemented it into our business and our systems. So when I give it to you and tell you, go do this, as long as you can follow those marching orders, like, you're going to win. You're going to be successful. So that's pretty much in a nutshell what the Dojo Doctors is and what it does.
And the other thing I liked about it, from what I've learned of it so far, is it's not like a get-rich-quick thing. You know, you have to put in the work.
No get-rich-quick, man. There's hard work, there's hustle, there's dedication, there's motivation. That's it. Like, I'm very successful at what I do because of what I do. Not because I started martial arts when I was 4. I'm 55. So it's 51 years of hard work, dedication, commitment, and hustle that have got me to this moment. The challenge is people see me at this moment and they're like, oh, I want what he's got. If you're willing to put in the work, I'll show you. I'll guide you. I'll push you in that direction and say, hey, now, whether it's business or whether it's martial arts, it's the same principle, right? Most school owners come to me, they're black belts in the martial arts, but they're maybe white or yellow belts, maybe blue belts in business. So I push them from blue to black in business so they can continue to grow and expand their studio and make a bigger impact in their community. Because you know as well as I do, the more people that do martial arts, the less problems we're going to have in the world.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I mean, we train a lot everyday people, but like even officers, there's a lot lack of training even in that area. And there's what little training you're going to do, whatever your training is, and what little training is, there's some coming techniques, there's going to the taser, there's going to the gun, not a lot of keeping distance, grappling, more places are starting to implement more things. But yes, I think it's such an important thing that you do, and a lot of people watching aren't just fans of your work. But they're also, martial artists, and they're also gym owners and school owners. So I wanted to bring that point up because I thought that was very important. But let's kind of go into real quick the future a little bit here. Obviously, you're doing an online thing to adjust to what's going on, which that is awesome. There was something that I actually didn't know this. You were recently on Instagram Live with this guy right here. And I didn't know that he used to be a student of yours, or was a student of yours. Is that correct?
That's right. Jason got his black belt with us, and I was instrumental in his training and getting him going. I was also very instrumental in getting him that role for Power Rangers as well.
I was going to bring that up. Yeah, just kind of like what you saw, what you and him were going over in that talk. You saw the light in this guy, the skill, the talent, and you kind of helped set him up with that gig.
Yeah, he was working for us. He was teaching. I mean, young, you know, he's 15, 16, 17, working teaching at the school, and very dynamic, great personality, super talented. And I got a call from my agent that said, hey, they're casting this new show called Power Rangers, but they're looking for, you know, younger guys, 15 to 19. And I got the perfect guy. So I sent him down there, and
he's ready to go. And you guys are actually, if we can talk about it, on another project together, correct?
Yep. Yeah, we're going to be doing a film called Legend of the White Dragon. It's going to, as soon as we get out of this COVID-19 thing, we're going to start filming. It's fully funded. It's ready to rock. It's going to be pretty epic. And listen, I'm not the only guy in it. You know, it's got me. It's got Jason. It's got, I don't remember all the names, but there's a lot of big people and good martial artists that are going to be in the film. So it's going to be really well done. The Bat and the Sun company that's doing a production company. So I'm really excited about it, and I'm looking forward to it.
Awesome.
Because listen, Jason and I have known each other for decades. I trained him and got him to black belt. He's gone on to do his own thing and become, you know, what he's become. And we've always crossed paths over the years, but we've never actually got a chance to get on camera together. So for us to be able to do that for the first time, it's going to be pretty exciting.
Oh man, that's gonna be awesome. Everybody's gonna be looking forward to that. All right, well, this kind of segment, I want to go over just kind of like some fun and other kind of interesting questions. So you briefly touched a little bit on this. Who are your martial arts inspirations? You briefly talked about Bruce Lee.
Yeah, well, my number one hero, as cliche as this sounds, but it is honestly true, and it's the reason I started martial arts, and that's my dad. My dad was my hero, still is to this day. I mean, to me, with what he did for our company and how he created our system, I mean, to me, he's like the Michelangelo of martial arts. And, you know, even to this day, he just had his 79th birthday, he's still coming up with ideas. Like, he's probably the most creative martial artist I have ever met, and I've had the opportunity to travel the world and meet thousands of martial artists, but I haven't met anyone who I feel, and I'm a little prejudiced, it's my dad, that's as good and as creative as my dad. So he's my number one. Bruce Lee, of course, like every kid growing up wanted to be Bruce Lee. I was no exception to that rule, that's for sure. So
does your dad, by chance, would he be interested, because he's got a lot of interesting stories, would he be interested in doing possibly an interview as well? Does he do things like that?
I can tell you with 100% certainty, he will not do interviews.
Okay.
I've tried to get him on. So I've tried to interview him myself. He's like, nope, not doing it. Come on, Dad.
Yeah, that's all good. All right, and then what are some of your favorite martial art movies, obviously outside of the ones that you've been in?
Okay, so we'll go to classics. Enter the Dragon, of course. I could literally say every line from that movie. that's number one. And I'll tell you my sleeper favorite martial arts movie is The Matrix.
Okay, yes, yes.
Besides, of course, Mortal Kombat, because, come on, Mortal Kombat.
Okay.
But The Matrix, I thought Keanu Reeves did a phenomenal job pulling that off. He did it. And, of course, now he's going on with the John Wick, and so his training and his skill has gotten, he's gotten better. But, and that's, you know, for anybody that's, again, trying to get into the business or doing things like that, I always try and give everyone the same advice that I got from Pat Johnson, who gave me this advice when I was first starting out. And it served me well over the years. And that is simply this. He said to me, he goes, Chris, they can take an actor and make them look like a great martial artist, but they can't take a great martial artist and make them look like an actor.
Interesting.
So he told me, take acting lessons. So I did. I signed up for him and did the whole process and, you know, doing all that. So that helped to open a lot more doors for me than just being an awesome martial artist is only one part of the equation. And there's hundreds, if not thousands, of awesome martial artists. So what are you going to do? What are you bringing to the table that's different than the next 45 guys that are coming in right behind you?
Awesome. That's great, great advice. Now, you, what all, I know you said your dad's a black belt, has mastered over 10 styles of martial arts. You yourself, what was everything that you do?
I do Red Dragon Karate, my man. It's everything I need. I've trained with some other great people over the years. You know, I trained with a gentleman by the name of Steve Fisher, and I got a third degree black belt in Shorinru under him, which is great. I had the opportunity to do some judo with Mike Swain, which is cool. So I've got a chance to train with some really, really incredible and talented martial artists. But as far as like what's here and what's here, it's everything my dad put together.
Awesome. I love hearing that. And you do a lot of weapons. What are some of your favorite weapons to drill or practice or shoot?
My favorite weapon is the Kama. Was the weapon I competed with, so it's kind of my baby. I love the double nunchucks. I really enjoy all the weapons.
Awesome. And I got a very serious question for you. Scorpion versus Blade, who wins?
Scorpion. Come on, it's like a contest.
I had to ask that one. what are you most proud of in your career?
Helping other people reach their goals. Awesome. That's it. That's it. Like doing this thing to get Jason to do what he did to help. One of my other students is Roland Osborne, who's gone on to create the hyper and the whole hyper martial arts movement. Helping other people achieve their goals and get what they want. Really, personally, whether it's in martial arts or in business, that's really my highlight. Now, if we're talking movies, well, of course, Mortal Kombat was catapulted me onto the big scene. It was an amazing experience.
Yes.
You know, my second favorite one though was this one right behind me, and that was Batman.
Yes, yes, so, I had a little bit in the clip. Go into that, like you were George Clooney's action.
Over George Clooney, yeah, in Batman and Robin, and that was amazing. That was $100 million film. So you know, you go from $30 million film to $100 million. It's a big jump in budget and the things that you do and. That was a great experience because, you know, if you think about it, I'm one of maybe 12 people on the planet that has ever worn the bat suit. And it's a really, really cool experience. I'm not going to lie about it. It was probably one of my favorite on-set things when they, and by the way, it takes about 30 minutes to put that suit on. They're drilling it.
It's got to be heavy.
It's heavy. It's 35 pounds of rubber and leather. It is not light and it is heavy to do. But once you get it on and they're like, okay, you're done. The first thing that you do is you find a mirror. The second thing you do is you stand in front of it and you look and you just say, I'm on that.
You got it, right?
That's it, man. And I'm telling you it was so cool. You know, and of course I got to meet Arnold Schwarzenegger, Uma Thurman, Alicia Silverstone, Chris O'Donnell. And that, it's just an all-star cast at the time. So that was really, really a cool, cool memory. Something I'm never going to forget.
Yeah, that's amazing. Yeah, the scenes you were doing, I mean, you made it look easy to move in that the uniform, but it probably was pretty laborsome. That kip up alone, I mean.
Yeah. So that was crazy. So what made it a little, it wasn't easy. I'm going to tell you, that was hard. It was hard work. And I could only be in the suit for 3 hours at a time because it's so heavy and so tight that you instantly start sweating. Wow. They would take the boots, Batman boots, off of me and turn them upside down. And water would just come out as if it was full of just a giant coffee cup.
Oh, man. Wow. So
the rule was, and they had learned because they had done a few other Batmans before that, you could only be in the suit for 3 hours. They had a person whose sole job it was while I was in the suit was to stand there with an air conditioning vent blowing it on me so that I didn't overheat. Because people had, you know, passed out. And it's kind of just like hazard work almost. But what was cool was when we were in pre-production, they gave me Val Kilmer's old bat suit to practice in. Because they came up with some stuff, but they couldn't let me take the one from the movie because it was going to be, you couldn't mess it up. So they go, well, we just did, you know, the one with Val Kilmer, take his suit. So I got to take that home. Of course, I took a ton of pictures in that thing. And because I pulled the flap out, it would say Val Kilmer on it, which was cool. But that's where we figured out how to do all the moves in the bat suit was we got a suit to practice in, figured out what we can do. The guy who was Robin, who was Robin's double, Clayton Barber, another world-class martial artist, him and I got together and when we were filming, they told us, you guys have done stuff in this suit that has never been done before. The fight sequences that we did, we were blowing them away. So here's the problem. If you remember the movie, there is fighting, there is Batman fighting, but that movie, if you go back and watch it, is more Mr. Freeze and Poison Ivy than it is Batman. And even Batgirl is in there.
Yeah.
The challenge, here's why. George Clooney at the time, he's a huge star now, but at the time, he was just coming off of ER, he had done a couple movies, and then he booked the Batman thing. So from what I've heard, the studio wasn't sure that he could carry the movie. Arnold Schwarzenegger was huge at the time. Uma Thurman, huge. Alicia Silverstone, huge stars at the time.
God.
So they ended up chopping out like the fight scene in the ice one that you refer where we did the kip up and stuff, we spent 3 weeks filming fight scenes in there that aren't in there. The garden section where we're fighting, we spent 2 weeks doing stuff in there. It's like 10 seconds on the film.
Real quick.
So when we were at the premiere and I watched it, I was like, oh, I was so bummed out. We worked so hard on that to do it. I would love to be able to get that footage of the stuff that we did for the fighting that just didn't make the final cut of the movie. That,
yeah,
I think would be cool. I think fans nowadays would really appreciate it.
Yeah, and there's so many people that you can just do even if the footage is like on some, a video feature or something, they can easily, people with, software now, could edit that in a certain way.
Yeah.
To include that. Because, yeah, I mean, even the flow of, the practice you did, it really showed, the movement, the flow of the cape, everything, it looked amazing. And, yeah.
Yeah, in fact, they bet me that I couldn't kip up in that suit.
Yeah, it was pretty impressive. Like, how do you do that? Not to mention, you're wearing like...
I will tell you this. The next day, I wasn't moving. Oh. I was so sore after that day of filming. We did that kip up, we shot that 7 times. 7 times I had to do it.
Dude, that's crazy.
Yep.
Crazy. Yeah, I mean, even when you were in the Mortal Kombat scene, Scorpion fighting Johnny Cage in like Scorpion's lair. I love when he did like the gymnastics giants to get up to the top, and very much like the like Indiana Jones, where they got the big swords like this and he just pulls the gun out and shoots, and we're like, just kick him down. But there's a scene in there, and I think Lyndon maybe at one of the more combat reunions, when it like some a stunt double did like a backflip and smashed his shins on the pole, which I think they left in the movie.
They did.
Brutal. Yeah. Well, just kind of wrapping up here. I really appreciate your time. A lot of people are kind of, sat at home. There's a lot of uncertain times right now. Any kind of like words of encouragement or wisdom that you can impart on them, just to have like a positive outlook?
Well, I mean, really, that's it. You've got to have a positive outlook. This isn't going to last forever. We are going to get through this. The country is starting to reopen. If everybody just follows the social distancing guidelines, does what they need to do, it will be sooner rather than later where we return to life as normal. There's a ton of people, they're protesting. Listen, I get it. My business got closed down. I'm as frustrated as anybody else. But the sooner everyone works together to get us to where we need to be, the sooner everyone starts making money again. Everybody starts getting back to their life as normal. We start to have, a lot more fun. Here in California, at least this weekend, they've opened the parks and some of the beaches. So, we get a chance to go out and enjoy that. It's going to be Mother's Day weekend. So just take the time to celebrate your family and your friends and stay safe.
Perfect. And when this is over, I would love to, we're able to travel again. I'd love to stop by your academy and
don't worry, you will. When you and I start working together, it'll be easy as pie.
Awesome, man. I really appreciate it. Real quick, before we kind of sign off here, where can people find you?
Everywhere. I'm on all the socials. Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, TikTok, YouTube. Just type my name in, and good luck with the spelling, but just type it in. Yeah, follow me on Instagram. Unfortunately, Facebook has a limit of 5,000 friends, so if you send me a friend request and I don't respond, it's not because I don't like you. It's because I can't get any more friends, but you can follow my page. You can follow me, like I said, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, LinkedIn. It's easy to find me.
Awesome. Well, again, thank you for your time for this. And I'm going to be giving you a call in a second here. And everybody check out, are you hosting it or is Daniel Pacina hosting it?
I honestly don't know. I'm not hosting it, that I know, but I'll be posting stuff on my story on Instagram.
Okay.
So, just follow me on Instagram, and as we get closer to it, I'll post it. I've got another interview coming up Thursday, and then Monday, and then Wednesday, and then the end of the month. So I got quite a few lined up. I'm looking at my board because that's where I got all my – don't forget.
Awesome. Well, May 27th, everybody at least check out Chris Casamassa and Daniel Pacina. They're going to be the two Scorpions go together there. And check out his social media. That's how actually I – happened upon a lot of your information, and that's been a great thing in these times. You can see just how involved, and you're really amazing with your fans, by the way. You really keep in touch and are involved. You care.
I listen, there's people that say it, and there's people that do it. I'm trying to be one of the guys that do it. I appreciate it. It's difficult. You know, I get a ton of requests for pictures and autographs and things like that, and I try and get them out as fast as I can, and people are sending me art, and, you know, this is a duplicate of a mask that a fan sent me. Max W Designs designed this, sent it, he wanted me to take my face measurements. So, you know, I love my fans. They are awesome people, and I appreciate their support. That's for sure.
Awesome. All right, well, we're going to end off here. Thank you very much, sir. I really appreciate your time.
Thank you.